Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Let's just take it back a little bit. One, two, three, shake. If I were all hands, you should dance on. Thank you.
Protection along the way. That's what I need him to be. Hallelujah. Hey, glory to God.
Thank
you,
Jesus.
Lord, put it on my heart to do this. Yeah. As I was praying, something happened to me today. I didn't have no words. All I had was some scriptures and a thought. But I started praying. And as I started praying, I started typing.
Thank you, Lord.
I didn't say nothing in English either. So how it comes out is how it comes out. But the scriptures are Numbers 33 and 55. Acts 9, 1 through 9, and 2 Corinthians 12, 1 through 10. And those particular scriptures all add up to this thought: the pricking of Satan. The pricking of Satan. I know we pray, but I need to do me some praying too.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
Father, in the name of Jesus.
Great marvelous name.
Lord, I ask you to take these lips of clay of mine. Pour in your oil. Mold, shape me, Lord God, that as I speak as a vessel of God.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord.
Oh God, the glorious gospel that you entrusted me with.
Yes.
Let it not be in word only, but in power. As Lord, as always, we bind every hindering spirit in the name of Jesus. And we plead the blood of Jesus over this sermon. That it be none of me, all of you, so that I decrease, that you may increase. And Lord, let those who are here and those who will hear have an ear to hear and a heart to receive the engrafted word of the Lord. For it's not your will that any man should perish, Lord God, but that all should come unto repentance. So we thank you for the gift of repentance. And we're so mindful to give you the praise and the glory and the honor. For truly you are worthy of all those. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
My God. We give honor to whom honor is due.
Amen.
Amen. Be people I know that have prayed for me and are still praying for me.
Absolutely.
I want to need y'all to pray me through this one now.
Yeah, take him through, Lord. Take him through.
Hallelujah. Numbers 33 and 55 states, but if you will not drive out the inhabitants of the land from before you, then it shall come to pass that those which ye let remain of them shall be pricks in your eyes and thorns in your sides and shall vex you.
Yeah.
I'm going to say that again. Vex you,
Jesus,
in the land wherein ye dwell.
Yeah.
Here the scripture itself plainly tells us that the pricks in the eyes and the thorns in the sides of the Israelites were the inhabitants of Canaan. The Canaanites were a type of satanic force that the children of Israel were supposed to defeat, yet they were not driven out.
Oh, my Lord.
You know, they defeated a whole bunch of them, but there was some that was left on the other side of the Jordan.
Yeah, it was.
And guess what? The Lord did warn. The Lord did warn. He prophetically spoke to him. And it shall come to pass that if you do not, they're going to be pricks in your eyes and thorns in your sides. How many times you done heard the Lord speak to you? They say, don't do that. And you do it anyway. And then some pricks. You get pricked. You get pricked. Mm-hmm. The children of Israel were supposed to defeat these Canaanites, yet they were not driven out.
Well,
so they were a continuous and unknowing presence in their lives throughout the Old Testament. How many people the Lord told you to get away from them? And you still go around them. Mm-hmm. Uh-huh. And now you wonder why, I don't want this person around me. Oh, God, Lord. Yeah, but you didn't do it the first time. So you got a prick in your eye.
Come on. Do it anyhow.
Acts 9:1-9 states, and Saul, yet breathing out threatenings and slaughter against the disciples of the Lord, went unto the high priest. Notice, he went to the highest religious man in the land. And desired of him letters.
Mm-hmm.
See, every letter behind your name ain't good. Ooh.
No, it ain't.
To Damascus, to the synagogues, that if he found any of this way, woo, hallelujah, the way. Are you in the way? Yeah, the way. You got to be part of the way. So the enemy come in like a flood under the spirit of the living God shall lift up that standard against him. Oh God. But he said, you got to be in the way. You got to, the only way you qualify is you in the way. Something about that word way. In the book of Isaiah, it talks about the way is a highway.
Highway of holiness.
That's what it says.
It's a highway.
Mm. How many money on the highway? But y'all thought y'all saw a detour sign. And then you ran into a prick. Now you back bleeding.
Mm-hmm.
You need the Lord to heal you. Because you went and took the detour. Because the Lord said it's straight. But you decided to take an exit on exit 25B. And when you got there, there was a rock waiting on you. A sharp rock. With jagged edges on it.
That's what we do.
Whether they were men or women, he might bring them bound.
What?
Bound.
What?
Under bondage.
What?
Oh, that about shout. Unto Jerusalem. You notice they didn't discriminate here? No misogyny?
No. Well.
But how y'all get misogynistic about the women preaching? I'm going to leave that alone because I know I can step on some toes with that one. And as he journeyed, he came near Damascus.
Where?
Damascus. Huh? That being the capital of Syria.
What?
Uh-huh.
What'd you say?
That's the capital of Syria.
My Lord.
It's still on the map.
It's still on the map. My Lord.
Mm-hmm. And suddenly there shined round about him a light from heaven. Notice it wasn't from hell. And he fell to the earth. And heard a voice saying unto him, Saul, Saul, why persecutest thou me? That's what that one word is read, y'all. Y'all should know who was talking to him. And he said, who art thou, Lord? Somehow Saul had some sense to call him Lord, even though he was part of the Sanhedrin, even though he had arrest warrants. The Lord said, I am Jesus.
Okay. Whom
I am Jesus.
Uh-huh.
That's what we're preaching. Him, Christ, and him crucified. That's what we preach here. Whom thou persecutest.
Uh-huh.
Trying to put a prick in Jesus. Well, Jesus got a word for that. Y'all try to put a prick in me. Watch this. It is hard for thee. Not him, for thee to kick against the pricks.
Well,
yeah.
Ouch.
You better stop kicking them pricks. You got all them thorns in your feet.
Ouch.
Uh-huh. Now you're looking for some tweezers.
Well.
And he trembling. And he trembling. Saul is trembling.
Yeah,
and he's astonished. Said, Lord, what wilt thou have me do?
Yeah.
You know, somehow he didn't come to his senses.
Mm-hmm.
He know he got these things, but he got these all these arrest warrants, but he said, Lord, what wilt thou have me do? Somehow Saul got a little wisdom. He got a little wisdom. You know what? You know why he got a little wisdom? The book of Proverbs teaches us what? That the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. Uh-huh. The fear of the Lord. Yeah, I don't know how many folks are God-fearing but don't have any fear of the Lord in them. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. They got that form of godliness. Mm-hmm. But they denying the power thereof. Mm-hmm.
That's what it did.
Uh-huh. He said, what will thou have me to do? And you know, and the Lord speaking back to him. So they have a good conversation here.
Mm-hmm.
And the Lord said unto him, arise and go into the city.
Well.
And it shall be told thee what thou must do. Notice Saul didn't stop to ask any more questions.
No.
No. All he started did was start moving.
That's it.
And the men, and they started moving too.
The men?
The men. There was some folk with him.
What?
Yeah. Which journeyed with him stood speechless.
Well.
They heard the voice.
Mm-hmm.
But seeing,
they
heard the voice.
They're a witness?
It was a witness.
A witness.
They heard the voice.
It's a witness.
How many times do you ignore when he's speaking?
Well,
uh-huh. That's why you're kicking against the pricks. But seeing no man. And Saul arose from the earth. And when his eyes were open, he saw no man. But they led him by the hand and brought him into Damascus.
Well,
shouldn't he have said that? And he was 3 days.
Three days.
Without sight.
See?
And neither did he eat nor drink. So Saul got smart. He started fasting.
3 days.
Uh-huh. 3 days. A 3-day fast. Mm-hmm.
My Lord.
Saul had been used a nuisance to the early church.
Yes, indeed.
He starts off with Stephen back in Acts 6 and 7. And 8. He was up there while they were stoning Stephen, he was there guarding the clothes.
Amen.
You know, folks think they're doing God's will. Folks thought they was doing God's will by stoning Stephen. They thought it was, but that is not what the Lord told them to do.
No.
No. He said, thou shalt not kill. He meant that. That means you won't be murdering nobody.
No.
Until one day he had an encounter with the Lord Jesus Christ.
Jesus.
Forever his life was changed. And he became a terrorist to the kingdom of darkness.
We got terrorists.
Yeah. We be moving furniture down in the kingdom of darkness. There's always a misunderstanding. they said they're going to bust your head to the white meat. That's what Saul started to do to the kingdom of darkness. Them demons started to flee. Of course, when they went back and told Satan about it, you know, he got mad. Back in the day, there was a movie called The Empire Strikes Back.
Whoa.
You know, Satan got a kingdom too now.
Yes, he does.
All right? It's called the Kingdom of Darkness. Of course, we know that the enemy strikes back. For vengeance. For vengeance.
Yeah.
Against the man we now know as the Apostle Paul, who wrote half of the New Testament.
Half.
13 books of the New Testament he wrote.
Really?
If you do your math, that's just 27. That's just a little bit under 50%. Second Corinthians chapter 12, verses 1 and 2 gives us the story of Satan's pricking. Paul testifies. It is not expedient for me, doubtless, to glory. I will come to visions and revelations of the Lord. You know, God was constantly speaking into Saul's life. He started saying, look, you're going to be a vessel of mine. You're a chosen vessel of mine. And I'm going to tell you what you got to say in front of folk. So every time, before he went to do some things, it's okay. He said, I knew a man in Christ. He's talking about himself. So he's giving his testimony in third person. About 14 years ago, whether in the body, I cannot tell. Or whether out of the body, I cannot tell. God knoweth. Such a one was caught up to the, which heaven?
Third heaven.
Quran says there's 7 heavens. Bible says there's 3. I'm going with the Bible. I don't know where they get the mother for. And when you see how them other, if you have to do your research, you see one man, when you get to that fourth or fifth heaven, you start seeing people with 7 heads and 6 eyes. And I mean, like, what kind of demon is this? An abomination. It ain't heaven. And I knew such a man. Whether in the body or out of the body, I cannot tell. God knoweth. He was caught up. So for y'all who say there ain't no rapture, how this man get caught up? Into paradise and heard unspeakable words, which is not lawful for a man to utter. Oh, but the Bible says, though I speak with the tongue of men or angels. he was there. So he had to rakarashandaria see. You know why? Because the people had stoned Paul to death. But the Bible says that the elders gathered around him. And they just didn't gather around him just to look at him. They started to pray. They started to pray in the Holy Ghost. And the Bible says Paul got up. He revived. And they let him out by a way of a bucket over the wall, and he got away. People tried to kill him. Satan sent somebody to kill you. But guess what? You can't go until God says it's time to go. Paul writes, of such an one will I glory. Yet of myself I will not glory, but in mine infirmities. For though I would desire the glory, I should not be a fool if I will say the truth. See, you lie, you're a fool. You tell the truth, you get wisdom. But now I forbear lest any man should think above that which he seeth me to be, or that he heareth of me. Now, it's all right to give honor to whom honor is due. All right? But don't be looking like Tweety Bird. You know, that head. And it expands and nobody can breathe in the place but you.
What's wrong with
it? Don't be like that. You're all puffed up with your arrogant and prideful self. And lest I should be exalted above measure through the abundance of the revelation, there was given to me a thorn in the flesh, the messenger of Satan to buffet me. And said, for this thing I besought the Lord thrice. That means three times he prayed about this thing. That it might depart from me. He wanted some deliverance here.
But what did the Lord say?
Yet he rather chooses the glory of his infirmities. And he said unto me,
he said, what?
He said, My grace is sufficient for thee.
Yes.
For my strength is made perfect in weakness.
Yes. Yes.
You got to remember who gives the grace, who's given the power. Most gladly, therefore, will I glory in mine infirmities, that the power of Christ may rest upon me. Therefore, I take pleasure in infirmities, in reproaches, in necessities, in persecutions, in distresses, for Christ's sake. For when I am weak, then I am strong. Many commentators have stated that Paul's thorn was a terrible eye disease called ophthalmia, which meant he had pus and matter coming from his eyes. Coming from his eyes. Can you imagine seeing that? And he got to preach all this pus coming out and all this matter coming out with other eyes with it. However, this could not be further from the truth. The scripture says that the thorn was a messenger of Satan.
Okay.
It was a demonic aggression against Paul's ministry. Everywhere Paul went,
everywhere he went,
the devil telling him to start getting people to mess with him. They tried to stone him.
Well,
they beat him with a whip.
Mm-hmm.
They threw him in prison.
Well, everywhere you
turn around, somebody's trying to mess with him. But you know, it was all in the plan of the Lord, because he said, I will show. He told Ananias, because Ananias had an argument with the Lord about Wallace. Mm-hmm. He's like, wait a minute, Lord. This man got arrest warrants for us. Mm-hmm. He said, oh, wait a minute. He's a chosen vessel of mine. And I'm going to show him how much he got to suffer.
Uh-huh.
How much he got to suffer.
Uh-huh.
Nobody want to suffer no more.
No.
Uh-uh. Y'all don't want to go through nothing.
No, he was
talking about me. Okay. Take stoning.
Talked about Jesus.
Mm. They talk real bad about Jesus. Dragged his name all through the mud.
Well.
And they did the same thing to Saul. They did the same thing to Saul. And do you know what happened here? He has a question for you. He said, how much demonic opposition do you and I face when witnessing for Christ? If we are honest with the Lord, we know that the grace that is in each one of us is more than enough to deal with the satanic attacks we face on a daily basis. On a daily basis. Mm-hmm. There's interruptions. You up here reading the Bible, the phone ring.
That's the truth.
You praying.
Mm-hmm.
Somebody texting you.
Yeah.
You in church and the phone vibrates.
All the time.
And I'm like, yeah, I'm in church now. I won't be bothered. I'm not going to see about this text. Whatever it is, it can wait till I get out of church.
Okay, that's right.
Mm-hmm. In other words, the power of the Holy Ghost operating within us is more than sufficient.
Mm-hmm.
As we hear the words of Jesus sounding in our hearts,
My grace
is sufficient for you.
Yes, it is.
How many know grace is the power of God operating in the believer?
Yes, it is.
Uh-huh. Grace leads to having anointing.
Mm.
An anointing.
My Lord.
And that's an anointing within.
Mm.
Yeah, that grace keeps you even under the heaviest of persecution.
My Lord.
Go ask them early Christians and see if you can take this, getting dipped in oil and getting lit on fire as a torch and strung up so Rome can be lit up at night so people can see where they're going.
Jesus.
Can you be a witness? Can you take that kind of persecution?
Jesus.
Can you be crucified upside down?
Jesus.
Like Peter was.
Jesus.
Jesus met him on the Via Dolorosa in Rome. And he saw the Lord, because he was running away. He said, Lord, where are you going? He said, I'm going to get crucified again. Peter looked down at himself and he said, oh Lord, I done messed up again. Me and my big mouth. No, Lord, I ain't going to run away from this. I'll be your martyr. But he said, no, y'all can't crucify us. Crucify me right side up. Mm.
No.
I'm not worthy.
Right.
I'm not worthy. Crucify me upside down.
Yeah.
Because my Lord got crucified right side up.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. My grace is sufficient.
Yeah.
The thorn, what's your thorn today?
Jesus.
What's pricking you today?
Well,
what's vexing you today?
Jesus.
That's that thorn in your side. That's that messenger of Satan,
you know,
sent to buffet you and I. What can it be? Could it be you got a temper problem?
Well, Jesus.
Could it be you got a woman problem?
Jesus.
Or a man problem?
Jesus.
Could it be emotional
problems? Yes,
Jesus. It's a messenger of Satan.
Yeah.
But the Bible says we overcome him by the what? Blood of the Lamb and the what? Word of our what? Testimony. In other words, he's coming.
Yeah.
He's coming. The Bible says in Deuteronomy 28 that the enemy will come one way. But he's going to run away seven different ways. Why? Because you belong to the Lord. If you belong to the Lord, the enemy's going to come at you. He said you got to suffer persecution. Yes. Everyone who would live godly must suffer persecution. But y'all can't handle nobody talking about you.
Jesus.
What about what they handle? Slapping across the face. Beard being plucked.
Well.
Been beaten 39 times.
Jesus.
With a whip. Uh-huh. Getting thrown in jail 3 times. Being stoned,
uh-huh.
Being shipwrecked.
Shipwrecked.
Uh-huh. We can't take that.
No,
no. And all, the only water around is salt water.
Uh-huh. My Lord.
Mm-hmm. Getting bit by a snake.
Jesus.
And then they shake it off.
Uh-huh.
Right into the fire. And then everybody, I'm good. Go ahead. Jesus said, "You shall take up serpents."
Mm-hmm.
He didn't say literally go be handling no snake. And like we got some nut jobs over here. You know that
they did.
Got bit. Because them things poisonous.
That's what
bit Paul. A poisonous viper.
And they
die. Paul, he didn't die.
No, he didn't.
No.
But these other folks,
God.
Dead.
They dead.
Dead.
They swole up and dead.
And not in heaven either.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, well.
But in all that, his grace came. You know, how did grace come? By Jesus Christ. Say, grace and truth come by Jesus Christ. The law come by Moses, but grace comes by Jesus Christ. He is the spirit of grace. Oh, God. So you can't insult him. You insult him, Lord, I hate it for you.
My Lord.
Because the place that people lie to you and tell you about, there's some two places that's in between you can go to. Ain't no such thing as purgatory. Ain't no such thing as limbo.
No.
No. Yeah. It's heaven or hell.
Heaven and hell.
No limbo. You ain't getting it. Yeah. Black sheep said the choice is yours.
Mm-hmm. So take your choice.
Limbo. Go with grace, which leads you to heaven,
mm-hmm.
and you get to walk that highway. The highway of holiness.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Jacob saw
that highway of holiness as he saw the angels of God descending and ascending upon the ladder. Nathaniel got to see it.
Yeah.
Jesus told him, "You go see the angels of God going up from heaven and down there." Visions and revelations of the Lord. The Bible says in Acts 2 that what your young men
shall
see what?
Visions.
Your old men shall dream dreams, and they shall all prophesy.
Prophesy.
Yeah, not prophesy.
Okay, you still.
Hey, yeah, you can't let. If you give a false prophecy, you keep on thinking that you're gonna keep getting away with it. Sooner or later,
well,
you got to pay it to the piper.
Well,
mm-hmm. And it was a well, but see. That's what that prick is. Mm-hmm. You hearing false prophecies, mm-hmm, and receiving them.
Receiving them
uh-huh, as truth. Mm-hmm. And guess what? Mm-hmm. They don't come to pass.
You know?
And you 9,500 years old, still at the church. Talking about, I'm waiting on God. I'm waiting on my ministry.
Well,
he said, get busy. Go ye into all the world. Go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. He didn't discriminate there.
Every creature?
Yeah.
Everyone.
Everybody. Lottie, dotted, everybody.
No.
See, because if you go in the grace of God, that thing which is sufficient for you to defeat the pride, to wash out, to put out all the things of the enemy that's coming at you fiery.
Yeah,
Ohio players talked about that, talked about fire, but we got some water.
Mm-hmm.
It's called grace.
Grace.
It's sufficient for you.
It is.
It's sufficient for you.
It is.
And it's sufficient for me.
It is.
Uh-huh. That's that unmerited favor. Because without grace, we all be in a mess.
Yeah.
Hell would be our holding cell.
Yeah.
And then when it's all said and done, we would all got thrown into the lake of fire.
Thank you, but no thank you.
Yeah, you'd be eternal barbecue.
Yeah.
With no sauce.
No thank you.
No sauce on it at all. It's dry and it's burnt to a crisp.
No.
And you the barbecue.
Thank you, but no thank you.
Now here we begin, and he says, Satan is constantly doing you. It's like having a pen constantly pricking your shoulder. Constantly pricking you in the side.
Uh-huh.
I don't want to be annoyed like that. You better get on away from here. In the name of Jesus.
In the name of Jesus.
Now don't be doing stuff in your name.
Be gone.
Yeah. Don't do that.
Mm-hmm.
Because if you do that, that demon gonna whoop you up from pillar to post, and you're gonna be bleeding and naked. Don't believe me? Ask them seven sons of Sceva. Mm-hmm. They up there. We adjure you by Jesus, whom Paul preached. I said, the man had the demons in him, looked at him, looked at all them boys. He said, look here, Jesus, I know. Paul, I know. But who are you? I'm sticking Paul every day. And he's still out there preaching the gospel. I can't stop him, no matter what I try. I done tried to kill him. I done thrown him into prison. And I still can't stop him. But you guys, it's going to be an all-night affair. Did y'all bring y'all lunch? Thank God for his grace. Because without his grace, if you couldn't go without God's grace, start breathing, but get your own air. That breath of life didn't wake you up this morning. Grace is over with. You got to meet your judgment. But as long as you are here on earth, you got a chance.
Thank you, Jesus.
The Bible says, this is how grace works. If you shall confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord, and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you shall be saved. For everyone who calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. That's how grace works. Sometimes you just say, sometimes you just say, Jesus!
Jesus.
And he hears that. And he hears that. You ain't got to say nothing else. Because he'll start pouring out some things upon you. An abundance of grace. And that prick that old Satan set up for you, it's going to fall off for you. He's going to be like, what you doing back here? Well, he told me in the name of Jesus, I got to leave, and I had to obey that right. Because the Bible says, what does it say? At the name of Jesus, every knee should bow.
Bow.
And if you remember in the book of Luke, chapter 10, when the 70 came back, they said, Lord, even the demons, because of your name. Jesus said it like this. He gave them a good answer. He said, don't rejoice that the demons are subject to you, but rejoice that your name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life. If you're in that book, oh, you can shout. You can worship God because the Bible says no man can pluck anyone out of Jesus' hands.
No man.
The only one who got plucked out was Judas.
Yeah.
Well,
sometimes we got some Judases around.
Did you say so?
We got some Judases, and they that's them pricks. They come to make sure that you stay humble. Because you can get the big head. I get the big head. And guess what? Sooner or later, you keep getting the big head, you're going to fall on your face. And you're going to wind up with a broken jaw, teeth missing, eye all out of socket, and a broken orbital bone. Then you're going to want somebody to come pray for you. Yeah, your head got busted to the white meat. But you still got to remember these words. Because Jesus has sounded it off. Even now, right in your heart.
My grace
is sufficient for you. God bless you.
Thank you.